მოკლედ ამ დოკუმენტურ ფილმებს ახლა ვიხილეთ ორი რეჟისორი ხავს, ძმები რიაჰები, იაჰი, არმანდა ალაშინიაკი და ერთერთთან საბოლოოდ შეთანხმდებით ჩაგოთებოდა და უფრო მეც გვესალმებოდა ამ გლობალურ საპროტესტო მოძრაობებზე, რეპერტუარებზე, სტრატეგიებზე, ბრძოლის ფორმებზე. ამანდა, ჩვენ ყველა შემთხვევაში გვაინტერესებს ისე ასვაპირებით აუდიტორიაში დისკუსიას. ამიტომ აი ყველაზე ცინცხარი და პირველადი შთაბეჭდებები თუ გაქვთ ამ გრუპთან დაკავშირებით, პროგრესში ვის მათ გსურთ, გვაინტერესებს. იმიტომ რომ როგორც თავიდან აღნიშნე, მშვიდობიანი არაძალადობრივი ფორმის ფორმებით ბრძოლის ტრადიცია გვაქვს, ეს ჩვენ ძალიან გამოცხო. და ამავე დროს გვაქვს თემატურად სფეროების და პრობლემების მიხედვით უკვე მრავალფეროვანი გამოცდილება, დასაწყისი ყველა შემთხვევაში საქართველოში სხვადასხვა მიმართულებით აქტივიზმისა, ამ აქტივისტურ ჯგუფებს შორის თანამშრომლობისა, ან თანამშრომლობის სირთულეებისა. ამიტომ აი ხოლთ ხელით აწერით, რომ აგვიზია შტაბეჭდები ხა ფილმი საკმაოდ მაღალი ტონალობაზეა მიმართული, პრინციპში თვლიან მთელი ფილმის განმავლობაში. და ხა კრიტიკა ამ მშვიდობიანი ბრძოლის ფორმების, ამ რევოლუციების შემდგომი ბედისგან ხოლმე ნაკლებად არის. ამიტომ შეგვიძლია მრავალი კუთხით მოხდენილი პრობლემატიზაცია.
შეიძლება?
დაკმო.
პირველ გამოცემდა გასული საუკუნის 90-იანი წლები, დამოუკიდებლობის პერიოდი და შემდეგ. სულ ასე ვი საუკუნის ვაქციები და ფორმით ეს ისე მშვიდობიანი, ნუ არც მშვიდობიანი. თუმცა მე ვფიქრობ, რომ მაშინ არსებობდა მშვიდობიანი პერსპექტივა, მაგრამ თავი იყო თავისუფლება და ისინი აღარიქმნენ ამისთვის. ფილმშიც უკვე ყველასკენ დავინახე, რომ მათ მთავარი თავისუფლება, თავისუფლება მათ მოუტანა ყველაფერი დასაქანებისა და ამ შეეძლო ხელი მათ ინტეგრირება საზოგადოებაში. მე ვფიქრობ, რომ აი მეცხრამეტე ან გასულ საუკუნის თანადროშირებით გასულ საუკუნის მოვლენებს გავს ეს ფილმი, გავს შინაარსი.
მე მადლობა უნდა გითხრათ, იმიტომ რომ მაგალითს მადლობა ჩვენ აქტივისტებს, რაც ვერცდებოდა ეს პროცესი ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანი ამის დანახვევად, როგორც სხვაგან. და ამერ მართლა აი ხოლმე ძალიან შეგაჩვენა მოხატებით პაციფისტები და მოხატებით შვიდები და დროულობა ჩამოვასვა და რაღაცა რაც შეიძლება ჩვენს ნამდვილად.
შეგაწყვეტია საკუთარი გეფში თუ გარეთან
ორივე. აცისადებს ვარი გვაქვს საკუთარი კეთრი გარეჩევას ეს არის ერთ-ერთი ესე. ამ ყველაფრის ნახვა და აი ამ სხვა აზრების გაგება არის ყველა ქონია შეხვედრა სხვადასხვა აქტივისტებთან, სხვადასხვა ფერმების და ყველა არ არსებობს ესე ერთიანი ფორმულა, ესე ყველა ინდივიდუალურია და ეს ახლა ჩვენთვის მართლა ძალიან დიდი პრობლემა იქნება, იმაში კიდე რაღაც სტრატეგია, რაღაც იდეები, რაღაცა მოგწონდა და მნიშვნელოვანი ყავს ნახვა და ვფიქრობ, რომ კარგი ხანი სადაც რომ კიდევ უფრო ფართონასების მისასვლამიც იყოს, იმიტომ რომ ძალიან ხშირად არის ეს სტოპდაზე ვარ თუ არა ვარ და ამის გაანალიზება და სპეცი გამომდის დანახვა ძალიან მნიშვნელოვანი ბევრისთვის, ვინც აქტიური არის პოლიტიკისა და ფიქრობის კანონ და არა და აღურები და ამის იძახეს რომ მოლოდოვანი ისწავლოს და ასე
შემდეგ. სხვა შეიძლება ის მეცმესკის ასეთი მოწოდებები და ხშირია კამათი, იმიტომ რომ ერთი მხრივ პრობლემაა, იმიტომ რომ არგუმენტი არის ასეთი, ჩვენთვის მნიშვნელოვანია, რომ არ წარმოიწყო ძალადობა, რომ შემნარჩუნო მშვიდობიანი ფორმა ბრძოლის, მაგრამ ძალიან რთულია ამ პრინციპს მიეყვა, როდესაც გიტარა, ხო, ელემენტარული ინსტინქტია, რომ მოიგერიო. ასევე მახსენებენ ამ ბრძოლის ძალადობრივი ფორმების ესეთ ხილვად ეფექტს, როგორც ის მნიშვნელობას, ანუ ერთი არის ის, რომ სტრატეგიულად თითქოს ძალიან მომგებიანი არავისო და მეორე მხრივ უკუმეტო ბადლობას მიიქცევს. თუნდაც არ არის ზოგადი, შეიძლება აუცილებლად ამ ადამიანებზე, თქვა პოლიციელებზე თავდასხმა, შეიძლება იყოს უფრო ხონების უბრალოდ ძაფრ დაზიანება ვიდრე ხონია გამოდი. და მეც მუდმივად აი მესმის ხოლმე ეს არგუმენტები და
და აგრესია იმ ხალაა ძალიან შეჭრფაში იქნება ეს ფალტოპროექტის ოპერატორ ლოჯიკის თემში პროექტზე იმ ხალხის სიამოვნებით რომ ძალიან ძნელია დაიჭირეს პუნქტი რომ არ იყო დაავადება.
Which for Johnny anyway.
Yeah, now we live in the 21st century, so it's possible to make a Q&A like this in the car.
Yeah.
So why shouldn't we take advantage of it?
Yeah. So let's start.
Yes.
So, great. So my name is Shota, and we have an audience here. We've just finished watching the documentary, which was really great. We are still under the impressions. Can you hear us?
Yes, of course, perfectly.
Great. So the first question would be, why not violence? Why peaceful protest? Because there are a lot of tactics and strategies. But why do you think non-violence is so successful? If it is, and we're going to also talk about if it is really successful in a longer run.
Yeah. So why non-violence? We don't believe in violence. So we think that it's wrong to be violent. We think that it's wrong to be forceful. And that's why we have a problem with this. And this is the project didn't start with this. Of course, we were pacifists from the beginning, and our parents educated us and raised us as pacifists. And we have a lot of the way that they think. We also think the same way. We think that we are against capital punishment and things like this. So somehow when we started to work on Everyday Rebellion and we saw the protests in Iran.
Yeah.
We of 2009 we had the feeling, okay, we have to do something. You know, we cannot just sit around. You know, or safe in our safe haven of Vienna, Austria, where it's there was the war for 70 years, and not do anything. And then when we started to work on the project, we realized that that there is a lot of movements popping up around the planet, but there is one common thread, which connects all of these movements.
Yeah.
And that was non-violence. So we were fascinated by the fact that there are people who are beaten down, and sometimes people they know when their relatives are killed, and they still stay non-violent, and they still stay peaceful. It's just for us some kind of like the next step of human evolution is to stop being violent. We think it's very romantic. Everyday Rebellion is a utopia. It's a utopian dream. It's not dystopian. It's utopian because we have the positive feeling that somehow it's possible to in a few years to have a peaceful planet where people fight without weapons and they find new ways to fight injustice, oppression, and things like this. And of course, the first really long time study of conflicts of the last 100 years, the one that we're talking about in the film, it also proves that non-violence is actually more effective.
So it works, yeah.
It works, yes.
Yeah.
So when my answers get too long, you can, I have no problem with you. Stop me.
Yeah, just some more
questions
if it is possible.
Yeah, of course, as much as you want. I'm in a car, I can go anywhere.
Yeah, maybe we also, I would like also to let the audience ask questions if there is any. And I will translate if it is necessary, if we need it. თუ გაქვთ რაიმე უკვე შეგვიძლია დასვა ან ამ სოფელში დავსვათ
და შეგიძლიათ
ქონდათ ამ სოფელში. And there's also another feature in all of these movements which are presented in the documentary. One is non-violence, it's a peaceful character, but also there is a kind of a claim that it is more network without leaders, more horizontal, and in the process of making the documentary, did you feel that this is a reality, that they have no actual leaders in the movements?
Yes, actually that. So it was in the beginning, for example, with Occupy Wall Street, it was very difficult to find to find immediately someone who is responsible for these things. I mean, it's so far in the eye of the beholder. So we went there and we thought we didn't know about these things in the beginning, you know?
Yeah.
We didn't know that how it would look like. So we also thought, you know, maybe we can. As we have to make a.
Yeah, sure.
I have to make a maneuver here.
Yeah. No rush.
You guys. So. Sorry.
Yeah.
So we were in there, and we didn't know anything about these movements and about the new ways they are working, you know. So we went there and we were also expecting to see some clear leader or see some people, and of course they had people who were responsible for several things, and I think it's not possible to you know, have a how do you say it in English, have a kind of, you know, that horizontal democratic, I don't know, kind of decision making, you know, because the problem is sometimes it's very difficult for these movements to make decisions. If this participatory democracy is a very complex and slow thing sometimes. So sometimes we have to make like small working groups or small affinity groups. Which has a huge rainbow, which you have to make small working groups and say, okay, these three people are responsible for this, these people are responsible for that. But it's really one of the strategies they have to stay alive, you know, and to evolve, is to not have a leader who can be killed, and then, you know, like, kill the rest of the movement. It's something that I think it has proven, or it will prove to be a good decision. But of course, they need to make sometimes quick decisions and have people who can claim responsibility for movements. But I think it's all about organization. You know, it's all about having the right people, make the right things, using manpower very efficiently, and using the talents of the people, of course, you know, because I think you can achieve a lot with very few people to get attention and to start winning the hearts of the people, that they see that you are a non-violent movement which is young, which is fresh, which has a vision. I think it's possible.
Yeah.
Sorry, I forgot what your question was.
No, we stayed on the... Yeah, and were you, or are you personally involved in any kind of activism, especially non-violent activism? Are you an activist? What's your personal experience?
Well, somehow... I'm not really an activist myself. I mean, of course, I go to protest, demonstrations sometimes, you know, the classic things that you expect of I don't know, political protests or something, but
yeah,
really not a lot, you know. So I cannot say for myself that I'm very much an activist, but somehow, of course, the decision to make this film to make this cross-media project, because it's not only a film, it's a cross-media project.
Yeah.
It's a website, and it's a smartphone application, and so on. It was an activistic decision. It was an act of protest by itself, the whole project, because we knew that funding the film will be different and will be difficult. And we knew that in the course of making the film, we have problems. I mean, in the end, we didn't have a lot of obstacles. But of course, it's we went to film with the people, and we tried to find ways to even film when it was not possible, for example, in Iran.
Yeah.
But I cannot say that I'm an activist, or that I was an activist before making the film. But with making the film, of course, it's a statement, because it's a protest against all dictatorships, and we're still working on it, and we're still feeding the website with content and feeding the movements and giving them, sending them the film, and we try to smuggle the film on USB sticks into Iran and so on. So it's for what. I believe a lot in the fact that the protest and the non-violent resistance can make use of the talents of the people for their own gain something. So we are filmmakers, and we come from this background of documentary filmmaking.
Yeah.
So this is something that we can contribute. Of course, it's necessary to go to the streets, and to somehow be outside, not only in front of your screen, but we thought that, okay, we have this expertise of filmmaking, and we have we are emotionally connected to this to nonviolent resistance and to protest, because our parents were refugees, and also political activists somehow, and that's why we wanted to make a contribution. So the project was from the very beginning, it was a political project and a very, very decisive and clear message, and a very clear act of protest against oppression and injustice.
You mentioned that it is a cross-media project. Does it mean that it's something new for me, at least? But does it mean that it's an ongoing project? You follow the heroes, you follow the stories, you follow the movements?
Yes, it's not only following the movements, but making a platform where we can, gather and still collect and somehow curate the nonviolent protest methods. So, very beginning in the very beginning of the project, we started to have this Tumblr website, where we were just collecting videos and calling the people to give us material and give us a lesson of nonviolent protest methods in their own countries. At some point we decided very, very early, even before we had this Tumblr site, that we wanted to make something for movements that stays and that is more than only a film. Because that a film is cinema documentary, it's dependent on the sales companies and the all the people who are involved in making a film happen and getting into the cinemas. It was for us, it was not our first film, so we knew it's going to be a question if the film is even shown in some of the countries where it would be very important that it would be shown, So we knew that we need something more than only the film, and that's why we made the platform. We made a website where you can find information about all the movements, you find thousands of videos, you see people commenting, you have, it's like a resource of non-violent protest methods.
And what's the general, general reaction, general feedback, what's general feedback from protest movements which you haven't yet covered, or from dictatorships?
Well, we don't know about the dictatorship groups, of course, you know, so I don't think that we are very popular with them, and with the public is very popular with the with the secret services or the dictatorships.
Yeah.
But nevertheless, we made it, and we think it's very important to push it. And we heard from a lot of activists independently from each other that they know the everywhere.net website, because somehow they told us that it's like anti depressant, you know, like a drug. Because the website is full of, you know, videos, and many people say that when they are sad, many activists, when they are sad or when they are hopeless and they think that, you know, they are alone on this world fighting against these things, they go to the website and watch a few videos and, you know, and get cheered up again because they see that they are not alone, and it's we somehow have the feeling that the best thing we can do is to create this platform where we have where activists from all over the world can can send their material.
Yeah.
And we give them a space to curate it, you know, to present it, so that everyone can learn from each other. But the funny thing is that all these movements,
yeah,
they are connected to each other somehow, you know. They know about each other, they somehow sometimes even use the same methods without even knowing that they exist or existed before, you know.
Yeah.
So sometimes a new movement uses things of a technique or a protest method, and then is very proud of it until they hear that some movement that they didn't know already used it, you know. And we think that that's the very universal thing about that's a very universal thing about nonviolence, is the fact that people have a feeling for it. You know, it's there and it exists, and people have a feeling for it, and it's very universal. Sorry, guys, just a second. I have to say goodbye to Jakob.
Take your time.
Okay. Thank you very much. Okay, guys.
Yeah, man. Do you want to finish your thought?
Actually, I forgot what I wanted to say, but I think I wanted to say that the cross media platform was very well received. You know, I don't know about the fact, you know, the people who are going to the website, if it's, you know, what the numbers are. I've heard that people who go to the website are staying there for a long time, so it's not typical internet duration of stay. It's not like 5 minutes, but it's, if people go to the website, they stay there for half an hour until 1 hour, up to 1 hour, which is a very good number actually.
Yeah.
And yes, we made a Kickstarter campaign last year, which was successful. So we are able to maintain the platform for another year or two, because we have two people who are constantly working on editing new videos and gathering new information about the movement and contacting them and, you know,
yeah,
getting into touch with them, and then of course covering what they do on the platform, new videos of the movements and so on. So yeah, it's a lot of editorial work, and it's necessary to do it because it's somebody has to do it, and it's very important to somehow support all these non-violent movements.
Yeah. You're doing a great job. I saw the website and also YouTube channel, and it has a lot of interesting videos. So thank you for that.
Thank you.
And in terms of feedback, we've just watched the documentary, but we have representatives of Guerrilla Gardening in Tbilisi, of Georgian
food,
and they are they're quite happy and very with the documentary. So thank you for that.
Thank you for the feedback.
One more question maybe before we let you go. So just be
able to. You can ask me. I need at least 15 more minutes until I can stop. So
yeah, great.
Go for it.
So we tried to talk about one of the central problems of social movements and political protests. It's non-violence, and we try to think. Did you have a case of interviewing or working with victims of oppression, of dictatorship, and how did they feel about non-violence? Was it always without problems? What's your impression of working specifically with victims and their families and their relatives?
So what we can tell you is that most of the time people who were activists or somehow politically active before they suffered from some kind of for example torture or something, is that most of the time these people were even more they were even more convinced of non-violence than before that, with people who were not activists before somehow come into all these problems of war and oppression and dictatorships and things that happen right now, for example Syrian places.
Yeah.
Of course sometimes they get angry and they want revenge and they take the weapons and start to strike back. But activists and human rights experienced people or somehow people who were before that somehow engaging in protests which were not decisively violent in the beginning, they are most of the time even more convinced of non-violence than before. Because of course, the more you think about it, if you stay rational, if you think of it very rationally, everything else doesn't make any sense.
Yeah.
So you have to be very, you have to be either in a very conflicted place like Syria, where you had, 500 to 1,000 fractions of groups fighting each other, where the whole country, like half of the country, is involved into a civil war. Or you have to be very, you have to have this this conviction that you're doing the right thing for your country, and also you have a little neck towards violence, that you really go into armed resistance, because going into armed resistance is something that not everybody can do, something it's very difficult, it's very unnerving, it's rough, it's brutal, going into armed resistance is a dangerous thing, and it's very, not everybody is made to do it. A very little amount of people are made to do armed resistance, but everybody can do non-violent resistance. It's much easier to convince people to join a non-violent movement than a violent movement, because they don't necessarily risk their lives. Of course, we have many movements where who suffer from dictatorship and from oppression and even maybe even torture or rape or worse things than that, But
yeah.
Either these people completely withdraw from they know how important it is to stay, you know, because of course people lose friends or lose family members due to protests and violence which is coming from dictatorships and police systems. Of course, it's not natural to be wanting revenge, because it's only a very unstoppable eternal cycle of violence. It will not stop, you know. So that's also why the Middle East, because so many people get involved into the Middle East, and it's so imminent to the clans culture of the Middle East and the Arab countries, you know, that somehow it's always about this cycle of revenge, you know, about this cycle of violence, because some families, you know, have been fighting each other for hundreds of years, so it's very clear that the children will also fight each other again, you know?
Yeah.
And that's what I think it's very important to stop the violence and somehow find these holes in this circle where you can connect to and stop this vicious circle. And that's why it's also very important to educate children on the fact that non-violent resistance even exists. You know, because some people think that non-violent resistance is only, you know, going to the streets and chanting, but it's not that, and it can be much more creative. It can be also very simple, as you could see with Gandhi. You know, there's many ways, and that's why it's also such a dangerous idea, which many systems try to fight. I mean, in Iran, the Iranian Secret Service knows about non-violent resistance very well. They even educate themselves about this subject, you know. So we know that for a fact that Iranian Secret Service is learning from non-violence. They even have a division which is focused on non-violent resistance.
Yeah.
So
what was your last point? I just want to make sure. So the intelligence are they learn from activists.
Of course, you know, sometimes the same way that activists learn from dictatorships and learn how to react to them. The movements have to be very clever, you know, because the dictatorships are also very clever.
Yeah.
You know, it's very simple. If the non-violent movement tries to find ways to mock dictatorships or to even frighten them, of course they will try to adapt to this and try to find ways to learn what non-violent resistance is, because many regimes are afraid of it because they don't know how to react, you know, because non-violent protest methods are not as simple to be. You cannot fight them so simple as you can fight a violent oppression, you know, because if you have violent resistance, you just have to be armed well and, you know, have a good strategy. But if you want to fight non-violent resistance, you have to be much more creative. You have to somehow find a way to adapt with this. And of course, the dictatorships are not stupid, you know, they will find some way, they want to stay in power. And that is why what activists have to know, that they are sometimes, of course, in for a long kind of battle, you know. And activists have to have a long stamina, you know, big stamina, because sometimes it's a fight of years. But no regime change or no system change comes within, you know, overnight. It always needs some time.
Yeah, for sure. So Arman, thank you very much. So for your effort, I hope we didn't make you break the law. Is it legal to drive and talk to this guy?
Yes, because I have this, you know, this, these cables, it's...
Yeah, so you're not holding, that's...
It's allowed. Without the cables, it's not allowed. Yeah, yeah, I'm not holding, so I can my hands free on concentrated, you know, focusing to drive. And I'm really amazed that it works so well, because usually Skype is somehow, the connection is always shit, and now it's worked, and I'm even in the car, so...
Yeah, that was amazing. Also, there was almost no technical problem, because...
No.
And please thank your brother Ash for this splendid documentary, we enjoyed it a lot. And
yes, thank you for watching. Thank you for watching.
Yeah, we'll be following you via Twitter and YouTube and your...
So, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thanks a lot.
Say hello to everybody. Take care.
Thank you.